Hello learners, welcome to the class on Gandhi's views on the depressed classes. This is unit 10 for the course MGP003. The course is on Gandhi's social thought. And I am Dr. Sunita Dhal, and I had already taken a lecture for this particular course, and today we are going to speak about Gandhi's views on the depressed classes. And in this lecture, we are going to understand what is the meaning of depressed classes and how do we contextualize the category of depressed classes in relation to Gandhian approach or Gandhian social thought. And we are going to discuss some of the debates or arguments with regard to Gandhi's views on the depressed classes. So with this introduction, I welcome you all again for the class, and let's start the class. And before we go into the lecture, I must acknowledge that there are certain terms like untouchability, which is not in use in the present context. However, we have used certain terms with specific reference to the history as well as to the self-learning material. So in this way, we are going to understand the debates on depressed classes and issues with regard to depressed classes in relation to the Gandhian approach and the framework. Gandhi and Ambedkar have unique place as modern Indian thinkers. Not only as thinkers but also as leaders, they led popular movements to eradicate evils of society and to recognize or establish society on the basis of equality and social justice. They both visualized for India an ideal society in which benefits and privileges will not be controlled by any one section of society but will be shared by all its members. In other words, they wanted to establish an egalitarian society based on the principles of equality and justice. The idea of social justice of Gandhi was more shaped by the Indian tradition than by Western liberal ideas. According to Tiwari, that it is difficult to categorize Gandhi as a liberal or as a socialist thinker, but in his concept of social justice, he included the principles of positive liberalism and democratic socialism as well. For example, Gandhi accepted the view that every individual should have the means to achieve his or her freedom, and also he believed that means of livelihood should not be monopolized by any one section of the society. The depressed classes occupied a central place in the Gandhi social thought with reference to the sufferings of the depressed classes. He was very much concerned about the practice of untouchability in the name of caste system in India. He strongly advocated that without social and material upliftment of the marginalized classes, India cannot attain true Swaraj. Gandhi called for strengthening the social cohesiveness and therefore tried to integrate various sections of the society for social reintegration of India for the attainment of Swaraj. Gandhi believed in Varnashrama Vyavastha in the Vedic sense, but not in the social sense in which it is divided the society into innumerable caste. And also, you know, you must have also come across the division of the society on the basis of caste and different social practices attached in relation to how you practice this, the caste system in, or how do you institutionalize in caste system in Indian society. The four Varna system as described in the Vedas was, according to Gandhi, based on human nature and on scientific principle. The defined duties, however, attached no privileges. I quote, he therefore thought that interdining or even intermarriage did not deprive an individual of his status that is his birth had given. It was from Tiwari 2009 431 page. caste being considered as an integral part of the Hindu social system, the enforced social hierarchy within which a large section of the society was categorized as untouchables. The term depraved classes refers to the community who belong to the lowest rung of the caste hierarchy, and they were placed outside the four castes. In the last decade of the 19th century, the term depraved classes came into use in official parlance. V.R. Shinde, a social reformer from Maharashtra, formed the Depraved Classes Mission Society of India and wrote in 1906 that the term depraved classes does not include the comparatively blessed human beings, holders of whom are still defiantly standing outside the pale of civilization in India, unquote. It was from the Indian Social Reformer, which was published in the year 29 July 1906, cited in your unit self-learning material. The social religious reform movements in India like Brahmo Samaj, Prarthana Samaj and Arya Samaj tried to draw our attention towards the social ostracism of backward community in India and called for eradicating the social prejudices associated with the community. You know, let us look at the contribution of Jyotira Govindrao Phule. Jyotira Govindrao Phule, a social reformer of the 19th century, in his book Gulamgiri, wrote about the subjugation of backward caste communities under the domination of the upper caste. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who was influenced by Phule's ideas, tried to explain the hollowness of the caste system and questioned the social and cultural basis of its origin and the origin of the practice of untouchability. The efforts made by the British government to enumerate the depraved classes separately in the census of India and to make special provisions for their educational and material development encouraged the mobilization of the community in different provinces since late 19th century. Initially, the British government did not interfere in the socio-religious matters of the indigenous society, like in India. Since early 20th century, there was change in the British attitude towards the problems or challenges faced by the depraved classes, hence initiated proactive policies to protect the interest of the community. The Government of India Act of 1919 made provision for nomination of depraved classes in the provincial legislative councils. Gandhi's views on depraved classes. Gandhi, from his childhood days, was very much concerned with the removal of the practice of untouchability. He was also of the opinion that without integrating the vast sections of the depraved classes in the larger Hindu society, it would be difficult to achieve Swaraj. Swaraj for me means freedom for the meanest of our countrymen. If the lot of the Panchama is not improved when we are all suffering, it is not likely to be better under the intoxication of Swaraj. I am not interested in freeing India merely from the English yoke. I am bent upon freeing India from any yoke whatsoever. I have no desire to exchange King Long for King Strog. Hence, for me, the movement of Swaraj is as important of self-purification, unquote. And it was written by Gandhi and published in Untouchability and Swaraj, Young India, in the month of June 1924, and cited in the unit in page number 97 to 98. The Satyagraha Ashram was established by Mahatma Gandhi in 1915 with a resolve to abolish the practice of untouchability. Gandhi coined the term Harijan, meaning children of God, to refer to the backward community. Gandhiji himself denounced the practice of untouchability existed in the Hindu society and launched the anti-untouchability campaign to raise the consciousness of the Hindu community about the wrongs inflicted on the Dalit community. He also aroused the backward class community to their rights and status in the society. Gandhi not only traced Varnashram Dharma as rooted in human nature and based on scientific principle, but also opposed any claim of privileges pronounced by any of four Varnas and condemned particularly the practice of social discrimination on the basis of caste, which thought not an essential part of Hinduism, however, had continued for across generations. He not only condemned the practice of untouchability and emphasized to make it a cognizable offense, but also made its removal a necessary component of his various constructive programs. According to Tiwari, Gandhi was very much concerned with the economic well-being of the weaker section of the society. Therefore, he transformed the nature of the Indian National Congress under his leadership and it became identified with the masses. And I quote, he fought, for example, for the cause of poor peasants in Champaran and for the cause of the industrial workers in Ahmedabad. In his speech at the roundtable conference, he identified the Congress with interest of the deprived section of the Indian society, and I unquote. Gandhi was against large-scale industrialization and the idea of a centralized state because he did not believe in the notion of authority and also the privileges to be enjoyed by a few. So he favored participation by all people in the governance of a country, hence supported adult suffrage. And I quote, the authority symbolizing the state must not be a privilege of the few at the cost of the many. If there was abuse of authority, it must be registered with the sole force, that is Satyagraha. Real Swaraj will come not by the acquisition of authority by a few, but by the acquisition of the capacity by all to resist authority when it is abused. Gandhi did not oppose to any representation of the depressed classes in the legislature. However, he was opposed to their social representative by separate electorates. The problem of the backward community, according to Gandhi, was primarily a social problem and could not be solved by special representation. He believed that special care needs to be initiated for the weaker section of the society and more particularly of those who had been the victim of social discrimination in the society. So in this sense, you know, we can infer that Gandhi was not opposed to representation of the depressed classes and also not opposed to machinery or the use of machinery for growth, but in a way he wanted a reintegration of all the marginalized sections of the society in the growth of the community and the country. In this sense, Gandhi wanted to create a society which believes in rationality, egalitarianism, and the principle of social justice. To Gandhi, one way of removing the practice of untouchability was by bringing about a change in our everyday conduct. The conduct of individuals should be regulated in a manner that will make it absolutely evident to the community that a better day has done for them all. For instance, says Gandhi, and I quote from the self-learning material, that you will begin by taking the Harijans along with you to the temple if you are in the habit of going to a temple. But if you discover that you will not be allowed into the temple along with your Harijan companions, then if you have the living belief that I have that untouchability is wrong, you will shun that temple as you shun a scorpion of fire. You will then believe with me that such a temple is not inhabited by God. And I unquote, it is from Harijan, which was published in the year 1936. When you go by the above argument, one can easily understand as to how Gandhi tried to address the issues of Dalit community without challenging the Varnashrama and its religious basis. To remove the social evil, what he prescribes is to bring about change in the social attitude towards the Dalit community by considering them as equal to others. His approach was to bring change in the minds of upper caste by exposing the hollowness of untouchability. His thinking was to remove the practice of social discrimination without much change in the Hindu social structure. In the light of constitutional safeguards and legal provisions for the protection of the depressed classes, Gandhi gave more emphasis on educating people to treat the underprivileged as equal and to allow them into temples, schools, and commonwealths. Gandhi firmly believed that without integrating various sections of Indian people in the movement against the British, it would be difficult to achieve political freedom in India. In December 1920 at Nagpur, in the annual session of the Indian National Congress, Gandhi said, and I quote, "The movement of non-cooperation can only succeed by complete cooperation from the people." The working committee of the Congress party later constituted a subcommittee to draw action plan for the betterment of the condition of the depressed classes throughout the country. In 1924, as president of the Belgaum session of the Indian National Congress, Gandhi brought a resolution asking the members to pay more attention to the needs of the depressed class, and I unquote. In 1930, when Gandhi launched the civil disobedience movement, he again reminded the Congress workers that the rights of the depressed classes cannot be overlooked for the cause of Swaraj. Many leaders of the depressed classes, being not convinced of Gandhi's approach towards the grievances of the depressed classes, represented directly to the British governments for rightful representation in various representative bodies. Gandhi was not in favor of special representation of the depressed classes because he was of the view that the problem of the depressed classes needs to be addressed by taking measures for bringing socio-cultural transformations in the society. Many leaders within the party were opposed to this approach of Gandhi. In 1932, Gandhi established the Harijan Sevak Sangh to initiate constructive program for the social and material development of the depressed classes. The Harijan Sevak Sangh started a journal titled Harijan to create awareness in the society for the welfare of the depressed classes. Gandhi traveled various parts of the country to educate people about the need for temple entry and removal of the practice of untouchability. In 1930s, when he devoted himself to the Harijan movement, he expanded its scope by incorporating the village development into the growth plan or the development of the country. In his own times, Gandhi faced strong opposition from a section within the Congress for his approach towards the cause of the depressed classes. In their opinion, the need of the hour was political emancipation. And once the country achieved political emancipation, the social emancipation would automatically follow. The depressed classes responded in different voices to the Gandhian initiatives for social and material development of the depressed classes. Although there were people within the community who found in Gandhi an advocate for eradicating the social evils, many were skeptical of the outcome of Gandhian initiatives. To Ambedkar, more than untouchability, it is important to understand the problems of the depressed classes. He was not agreeable to the Gandhian suggestion of treating the issues as a religious question. Gandhi had the ability to harmonize and unite the differing perception and voices to achieve the desired goal. by being sensitive to the sufferings of the depressed classes and also understanding the growing social consciousness as well as the political strength of the depressed classes, Gandhi at the end tried to bridge the gap between the upper and the Dalit community. And with this, I conclude the lecture. And you know, this lecture is a preliminary lecture on the Gandhi's views on the depressed classes. And you can always refer to your self-learning material to be able to understand more, you know, the concept or Gandhi's position on the depressed classes. And for this lecture, I have followed the self-learning material as well as some other references material which have been placed in the reference slide of this lecture. And with this, I thank all of you.